our war.
Yes.
We need to leave this place.
No supplies coming into the city, no nothing going out and nothing coming in.
Africans caught up in the horror of the war in Ukraine.
We are students, we are not fighters. This is not our war, it is not our fight.
We want to go.
We want to go.
As they flee, many will be treated as second-class citizens.
We are not allowing any black people to enter inside the gates.
Only Ukrainians, that's all. That if you are black, you should walk.
It was horrible. It was uncalled for. It was deeply inhumane.
I'm Peter Okwoche. I'm a presenter on Focus on Africa on BBC World News. Since the beginning of the war in Ukraine, I've been covering it for our African audiences and also narrating the experiences of Africans who've been caught up in that conflict. I needed to go there and talk to these people myself, touch flesh with them, and make sure that their stories, their voices, were heard as well.
Shashamel is a 30-minute drive from Madika. It's one of the big towns in this region.
In all the chaos that was unfolding in front of my eyes,
people, a lot of Africans here.
I wanted to find out who are the Africans who got caught up in this conflict.
I don't know where the bomb was coming from, where the rocket is coming from, here or there. So there was like chaos, total.
The city is encircled by the Russian army. We cannot pass, we cannot go anywhere. So we are begging for help.
What do we want?
We want to go!
What do we want?
We want to go!
But will they make it out?
We don't have light.
We don't have water, we don't have water, we don't have light. And now our telephone will be low. The battery will be low. Please help us.
Can I ask you to maybe just describe what the situation is like there at the train station?
Oh my God, it's tension. It's tension. It's like people are fighting to get into the train. There are soldiers everywhere.
This is Becky Adong. I speak to her while she, her husband, and two young children are waiting in Kyiv, Ukraine's capital, hoping to get a train out of the country.
Sorry, my voice is a little bit cracky because the situation is just over me.
We are scared.
We are really scared. This even scared is an understatement. I don't even know which English word to use.
Terrifying.
Becky and husband Michael, both from Uganda, have lived in Ukraine for more than 10 years. Together, they form a music group called Alpha Alpha. Their children, Daria and Dimitri, were both born in Ukraine. The whole family speak fluent Ukrainian and Russian. In this video, filmed before the war, Daria and Dimitri are playing in the very same train station they are now trying to flee from.
My children are, I feel so bad for them because this is their home. This is the only place they know. They have not even been to Uganda.
By the time we speak, the war is 2 weeks old. Almost 2.5 million people have fled Ukraine into neighboring countries. Ukrainian men between the ages of 18 and 60 are forbidden from leaving the country. Families are split as women and children are trying to get to safety. Among streams of people trying to leave are many Africans who are living or studying in Ukraine. Reports started to emerge about discrimination against them.
We walked. I walked for 12 good hours, and it's not an exaggeration.
Jessica Orakbo is a Nigerian medical student who was based in Western Ukraine.
I walk in.
After spending a night in a makeshift shelter on her way to the Polish border, she says she was stopped from boarding a bus.
I even lied that I was pregnant. They didn't care. I was begging. The official literally looked me in my eye and said, in his language, only Ukrainians, that's all. That if you are black, you should walk.
If we went on social media, everybody was talking about how Africans were being treated in Ukraine as they fled this conflict.
Listen, man, these people left without taking the blacks. Man. None of the blacks, man. See.
These are the black community. We are not allowing any black people to enter inside the gates. We are all here. It's only Ukrainians that they are allowing in. Even the ones with kids, they're not allowing them.
Dr. Awofa Gogo Abite is a Nigerian surgeon and university lecturer who lived in Ukraine for almost 14 years. He filmed his escape.
I love Ukraine. Ukraine has contributed to a significant part of my future. It's a quite difficult part of the world to integrate for people like coming from Africa. But of course, I give the country benefit of doubt that it's a young country and doesn't have that long history of diversity.
Dr. Awofa was in Kyiv when the Russians invaded.
On the third day, the bombardment increased drastically, and I knew I had to leave. Our nightmare started in front of the border, where authorities were very cold. They didn't answer to anyone. And I have to be fair, actually, they did not answer to their own people. And if they don't answer to their own people, you can expect worse to us.
Dr. Awofa arrived alongside other Africans at the Ukraine border with Poland at 4 p.m.
We barely moved an inch till midnight, and Ukrainians just kept moving. They kept moving. When some people tried to complain, they said, well, we're allowing just women and kids to pass. But if you say women, there are black women here as well. There are women, why aren't you letting them pass?
The temperature was freezing, and there was no shelter. It was so cold, Dr. Awofa says, the water in his bottle froze.
So at the end of the day, we were the last, if you can see in the footage that I sent, we were the last people for over 18 hours who were let to pass. It was horrible, it was uncalled for, it was deeply inhumane.
Becky, Michael and their children also made the journey from their home in Kharkiv to the Polish border in the early days of the war.
When you get close, you're either pushed back or you're told to come back the next day. And the temperature, it's really cold, very cold. So it's a decision of two devils. You either die by the cold or come back and die with the bullets or the shelling.
Going back home to Kharkiv, which is also known as Kharkov, was not an option. It was one of the first cities attacked by the Russians.
Kharkov was bombed. Houses were being hit. And, you know, anything could happen.
Nigerian football coach Obi Ujimadu and his family were also living in Kharkiv when the war broke out. Their family had been in Ukraine for 17 years.
When you start hearing these explosions, even getting closer to you, it's heart-wrenching.
The family took shelter in the basement of their home.
There was nowhere safe, actually. And how long are you going to stay, you know, in the basement? So we decided to move by train to the city of Lviv.
We're all good, guys. We're all good. God is with us.
Just after the war started, I reported from Chemyshel, a small Polish town on the Ukraine border. I found myself surprised by being so shocked at what I saw there. You know, we've covered conflicts on the African continent where people have fled, but you've never seen 1.5 million people flee in 1 week. Myself and my cameraman, Amir Ahmed, were the only black journalists that I saw in Chemyshel. As Africans came across the border, we were there to meet them.
Gentlemen. Yeah, say, where are you from? He'd say, I'm from Ghana. I'll say, ah, Charlie, how buddy, how you day? You did well, you know, and then you'd see they'd perk up. Oh, this is somebody like us. This is somebody who actually knows who we are.
Despite these Africans finally leaving the war behind, for some, there was still fear in the air.
dans tous les parcours là, de l'Ukraine, venir jusqu'en Pologne, jusque là où je suis arrêté comme ça, je ne me sens pas en sécurité. Parce que là, quand je passe, je vois des regards des gens, je sens, je sais, ils vont faire quelque chose, ils vont me battre quelque chose, je ne sais pas, j'ai des réflexions, je ne sais pas exprimer exactement.
My crew and I sensed this feeling of racism in Poland too. We were turned away from two restaurants for no reason. And amid false rumors of a migrant crime wave, we were confronted by a menacing group of men who demanded to see our BBC IDs.
Because of this experience that I'd had, you know, this very uncomfortable experience of somebody judging me for my skin color, it made me understand what these people who had crossed from Ukraine were telling me. And for them to say it was worse on the Ukrainian side, I just can't imagine.
It's a very complicated situation because they don't want the world to see what's going on because it complicates the issue. It's such an irony, it's such an oxymoron. My Ukrainian friends, some of them try to make excuses and tell me that it's a wartime and such things are bound to happen. But I know that it's not just about a wartime. It's always been like that, and I know in the war times it will just be amplified.
You're fighting in a war, and you still have time for racism. It just didn't make any sense.
Later, I got a chance to interview the Ukrainian ambassador to South Africa.
What's your reaction to all these reports about the way Africans who are trying to flee the fighting in your country are being mistreated by Ukrainian border guards?
This is absolute nonsense because me personally...
I've seen them and I've spoken to these students. I just came back from Ukraine.
I also speak to the students, I speak to their parents, and the situation of war is when every single person is trying to escape and to struggle for his or her life. And that's exactly what was happening.
I don't want this part of the story to overshadow what's happening in Ukraine. The Ukrainians are being bullied. But if in turn the Ukrainians are bullying a small group of people, I think that story should be told as well. Everybody's suffering counts. And I think that's why telling this story in its entirety is very important.
The UN High Commissioner for Refugees has acknowledged racist treatment at Ukraine's borders. The Ukrainian government has said Africans should be offered equal opportunities to return home and promised to spare no effort to solve the problem.
Yeah, we just arrived to Lviv.
Not all Africans encountered racism as they escaped from Ukraine. Obi Ojimadu and his family were much moved by the reception they got as they crossed into Hungary.
The love shown is overwhelming at the borders. Little things, but they make you feel like crying.
Irrespective of who you are, whether you are like, you're Ukrainian or you're not Ukrainian, as long as you are coming out from Ukraine as a refugee, everybody's been well taken care of you.
We started hearing good news about how many people had made it to safer countries, but there were still so many of them who were desperate. Some people, every day they'd try and escape and they'd have to go back because the roads were bad, because the bombing was still going on.
We really need to leave today because places like Kharkiv have been blocked. Mariupol has been blocked. They also can't come out. They don't have gas, they don't have water, they don't have medicine, they don't have food. So if we don't leave, we might also be blocked in.
Electricity was cut off, so a lot of them couldn't charge their phones. It was more and more difficult to get in touch with people and see what their daily lives were like.
As we understand it, there is a concerning number of students, foreign students, who are in Sumy and unable to get out.
So the situation is very, very serious. Like, it's very dire. And they're now starting to lose hope. Every day in the chat is just, help, help, please, can you help us out? Please, please, can anybody help?
A large group of African students stuck in Sumy, northeastern Ukraine, were posting videos online.
We have nothing at all to do with this war. Early this morning, 5 a.m., 4 a.m., we are woken up with how many bombs? Six.
Five.
It was six. I counted each and every one of them. Six.
I saw a Russian force advancing towards the city. Most of you are now here. If you saw what I saw, you will know that us, any single minute, every single second we spend here is a danger to the life of every single one of us.
There is no food at this stage. We are running out of supplies. How long do we want to continue doing this? Please, what do we want?
We want to go home.
What do we want?
We want to go home.
Thank you.
Students in Sumy were not the only ones appealing for help.
Peter Okwoche is on the ground for us.
A report has reached us today that the Russian army has surrounded the southern port city of Kherson.
On March the 5th, Kherson was the first Ukrainian city to fall since the invasion began.
We cannot move at the moment because even people who have tried leaving the city, they've been stopped, they've been blocked by the Russian soldiers. So when we try to go with a private or personal cars, the Russian soldiers start shooting at us.
The stress, tout ça, franchement, ça va pas. Parce que rester comme ça, suivre les bombardements partout, c'est pas évident pour
nous. C'est traumatisant. C'est compliqué, on dort pas. On vit comme, nous sommes les étudiants.
On a eu à contacter pratiquement toutes les autorités, mais jusqu'à présent, on laisse toujours en stand-by.
D'attendre.
Bon, là maintenant, comme on dit souvent, c'est le terrain qui impose la manœuvre. Parce que là, vraiment, nous sommes dos au mur. On remet tout entre les mains de Dieu, mais si prêt à lui, demain, après, nous allons partir.
Team was waiting for days to find out what happened, but we had no idea. We couldn't get in touch with them, and it was a very tense period for us. Another student stuck in Kherson was Oche King. Through intermittent internet access, he too sent us updates.
There was a lot of explosion, and we do hear gunshot day and night. We sleep hearing gunshot, and you wake up hearing explosions and gunshots. We call on all the embassies, the Nigerian embassies and most of the African countries' embassies to come together and please address the situation. We want to leave this place immediately. And we'll be very grateful if our situation is attended to.
While people in cities like Sumy and Kherson were pleading for humanitarian corridors, past experience had shown even those were not guaranteed to be safe.
It's very scary when you hear that buses that are carrying innocent souls are being bombed, and yet they say that it's a safe corridor, but buses are still being bombed. Mariupol, they can't get out. We had a concert there, so we have fans, we have friends there.
On March the 9th, Russian forces attacked a maternity hospital in Mariupol, reportedly claiming the lives of five people, including this woman and her unborn child who did not survive their injuries.
Pregnant women, these are women that are carrying the future for tomorrow. My son is not sick, but I feel so bad, I feel so scared. I see how he shakes. When the bomb goes off, he can't hold nothing. Everything he holds just pours. He has to have his doll. He has that doll he holds. He should have it all the time. He squeezes it like his fear. He puts it there.
Then finally, some positive news. 35 buses managed to reach Sumy, taking more than 1,000 trapped international students to safety. That same morning, I managed to speak to Timmy, a Nigerian student who had made it out of Sumy on his own and had reached Budapest only hours earlier.
I tried to leave Sumy twice. The first one was not successful because the driver that took me, he didn't know that they have blown up the road that we're going to pass, the Kharkiv Sumy road, the bridge. The road was blown up. So while we got to the bridge, found out that we couldn't pass.
So you had to abort that trip. When was the next time?
The next time was when I finally left on Sunday. I called like over 20 or 30 drivers. They all didn't want to go. So I was finally lucky to get a driver that would go. So it's not about luck. It's luck. It's not about your money or anything.
How much did it cost you? Because I know some people paid quite a lot of money to hire these taxis.
About $1,000.
How long was this drive?
About 4 hours. 4 hours.
What about the students trapped in Kherson? So most of our conversations dried up. It was really difficult to get in touch with a lot of the people who were still trapped in there. But when we managed to, they were still asking for help. Several foreign students wanting to flee the region are stuck in Kherson. One of them, Jerry Kenny, has been speaking to us.
No aid has come from the Nigerian government in terms of food and water. Nobody's complaining. We don't want it. What we want is for you to do everything to evacuate us from here. We want action before it becomes worse.
But getting students like Jerry out of Kherson was easier said than done. Russian soldiers had occupied the city and locals were protesting against them. A video of them confronting military vehicles with Russian markings went viral. Tensions were rising. We were very worried about everybody that we spoke to. They became people who we cared deeply for. On March the 30th, we received worrying messages from Okwoche. There is no way out. The battle is drawing closer to the streets. The war is very serious now. Becky relayed a message to her Ugandan family.
My mom, mommy, I'm fine. I'll be fine. My sisters, I'll be fine. We'll make it through. I just pray we make it through. It's difficult.
Some good news from Jerry Kenny. With support from NGOs, he escaped with others from Kherson and made it to Poland.
Before I left, I said something. I said, is that I cross that border or nobody crosses that border? So I have this faith that I'm going to make it.
On the way, he says he was stopped by Russian troops.
It was terrible. I was stripped off my clothes. Tried to touch our skins and we're like, what? This is my skin. I don't have any weapon on me. You can see that. Why did you have to strip me off? So we're just with our trousers only and there's nothing we could do. We're cold. People are just looking at us and standing just like up naked on the main road. Just we, this is not a general thing they did. They just did it for just three of us. The foreign guy from Palestine, myself from Nigeria. It was so cruel to us.
Eventually, they were set free and managed to catch a train.
I wasn't scared of my life, but I was scared about the people that are coming behind me and the people I'm going to send for. But I thank God everything went well.
Becky, Michael, and their children messaged us to say they had managed to make it onto a train from Kyiv. Choo-choo. All we could do was wait to hear if they made it to safety.
Say something.
4 days later, news came in. They had arrived in the German capital, Berlin. With the help of the local Ugandan community and the Ugandan embassy, they then moved in with a German family under the German-Ukrainian refugee program.
We are here once more because we have.
After weeks of silence, we found out the Kherson students had escaped. But Okwoche King had no such luck. He remains trapped.
Looking at this whole experience, trying to look at the whole picture in its entirety, the underlying story there is the Russian invasion of Ukraine. And that must not be forgotten. That is very important. But within it all, I was touched by the fact that despite the experiences that many of these migrants had gone through, many of them still felt that Ukraine was home, and many of them said they would go back. You know, despite everything, they still felt that affinity to Ukraine.
As the Ojimadu family left Ukraine, one of their daughters, Tyra, sang a Ukrainian folk song, which mourns the loss of a beloved homeland. Will Becky and Michael's Ukrainian-born children ever find peace again in the country they called home?
Hello!
Becky hopes so.
As they say, victory for Ukraine, yeah. I wish them victory. As they say, Slava Ukraina.